So good morning all of you, welcome to, good afternoon all of you, welcome to the next session of Dermatology on Let's Crack Neet PG. I hope I'm audible and visible to everyone. I want a thumbs up from all of you if my audio video is clear. Please give me a thumbs up if my audio video is clear. Okay, very well done. So welcome to this session of Dermatology on Let's Crack Neet PG. Just a brief introduction, I'm Dr. Cheshta Agarwal, your Neet PG educator on an academy. And I have myself scored all in their rank 261, so I will give you the tips and tricks which is required to crack your exam as well. Okay. Before going ahead, a little bit about Unacademy. So Unacademy Learning App is the online platform for the preparation of various PG courses, and it is one of the best course for the preparation of NEET PG. Now, why this is the best online platform for the preparation of NEET PG? Because this gives you the live interactive sessions. What do you mean by live interactive session? It means that during a live class, you can ask any doubt to your educator. So during a class, asking a doubt is a feature like that of an offline classes where you are sitting at your classroom and asking the doubts. But at the comfort of your home, and I think everybody know that now in this corona time, you have very difficulty in going to different places, traveling long distance, staying in an apartment or like that. So in this period, this is the best platform and all the top educators of the country will teach you at the comfort of your home. That was the first benefit. What is the second best part of Unacademy? Unacademy gives you more than 60% of the things for free. Now, what do you mean by free? Free means you just have to download the app and you can easily access the free stuff. We have special classes where all the educators take live interactive classes. The next is you have quizzes and test series. Test series means every day there are certain time slots where you have questions targeting one of the exams. For example, at 8 p.m. we have a session for NEET PG. At 8:30 we have FMG test series session. At 9 p.m. we have a next test session. So like that, we have different time slots where we are giving you free test series. Whatever you are reading, you can easily revise or practice using these test sessions. And the third is something called as Unacademy Combat. Now, this is a sort of scholarship test which occurs every fortnightly, that is every 15 days. What happens in this, please remember, they will give you subject wise test and the toppers of this test will get Amazon cash vouchers or an academy subscriptions. So this is sort of a scholarship test where if you score good, you can get a subscription of an academy absolutely free. All these three things are available for free on an academy. You just need to unlock them. And which is the key to unlock these? The key is the invite code. Please remember the invite code is Cheshta10. That is my name and 10 in front of this, or Dr. Cheshta YT. YT stands for YouTube. Dr. Cheshta YT or Cheshta10 is the invite code or key to unlock all these free sessions on an academy platform. Now we have the remaining part is the paid part. On paid, we have many batch courses which are specially created targeting a particular exam. For example, everybody knows that the pattern of NEET PG, suddenly there was an announcement on in the month of February that instead of 300 questions, you will get 200 questions now. So for that change in pattern, we have created a batch course, and that is a system-wise clinical rapid revision batch course. Please remember, this is very important. This is very important with the respect that in this batch course, we will give you an idea what change you can expect in your upcoming NEET PG entrance examination. And this type of last moment course is not given to you by any other platform. So that is something which is best about Unacademy. They give you every month new batch courses targeting your upcoming entrance examination. How to get yourself enrolled into this? There are two types of subscriptions, plus and Iconic. Now, Iconic is best if you are in your MBBS now. For example, if you are in second year of MBBS, third year of MBBS, and if you are in your final year of MBBS. This is because it gives you access to both Unacademy and Prep Ladder. You have minimum 1 year, 2 year, 3 year subscriptions. And longer the duration of subscription, lesser will be the per month cost. I will request you to get a 1 year subscription of 55,000 rupees and use the code CHESHTA10 to get the same subscription in 49,500 rupees. Okay, so you will have amazing discount. Use the code DrCHESHTAYT or use the code CHESHTA10. Anything can be used to get amazing discount for those who are planning for NEET PG 2021. That is this year NEET PG or INICT or FMGE, get a simple plus subscription of 1 month. Use the code to get additional discount on the subscription fees so that you will get it in 4,500 rupees. But you can even take it for a longer duration, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, etc. and so on. So please go ahead, subscribe to Unacademy. And the last notice is, that's what I've told you, there are many free test series going on for NEET PG, FMGE, Next Pattern, INICT, Grand Test, Scholarship Test. Get yourself enrolled. Please take the benefit of the free stuff which is present. Okay, so we are done with all the information. Starting with the first question, please answer the question given on your computer screen. Today's session is very important. A lot of good questions are curated and put on the screen today. Please answer this question, everyone. Female presents with active genital warts with history of recurrence, but her husband doesn't have it. What is the advice you will give to prevent the transmission? Very well done, all of you. We have a good number of students with us today. Read the question carefully. The question says that a female patient presents with active genital warts with history of recurrence. Okay. But the husband is not having any lesion. Now, what will be the advice given by you to the patient so that the husband will not get the disease which the wife is having? So, what will be your answer? Give continuous prophylactic antiviral to the patients. Give prophylactic antivirals to the husband. Give antivirals whenever active lesions are present, or don't involve in the sexual activity when the active lesions are present. So, what will be your answer? Venkatesh, I've given me one option. What about the others? Please remember, this is a direct question I have taken from AIMS exam. Recent AIMS exam 2020 or 2019 AIMS exam, I have included this question. What will you advise to this patient? Please remember, all my dear students, that there is no preventive therapy. Neither presence of any vaccines or any drug which can prevent the development of genital warts. So you cannot have option number 1, option number 2 or option number 3 as the answer, because you cannot give anything to the husband to prevent development of the disease. The only one thing which can be given to the husband to prevent the development of the lesion is that the husband should not get involved in the sexual activity when the active lesions are present. Please give me a thumbs up if this point is clear. There is no prophylactic treatment available. Only that husband have to avoid having sexual intercourse with the wife when you have active lesion seen. Please give me a thumbs up if this question is clear. A very important one. I request everyone to please give me a thumbs up. Please give me a thumbs up, all my dear students. Very nice. So the answer was option number 4. Let's go to the next question. Please read the question carefully, very, very carefully. A 3-year-old female born out of third degree consanguineous marriage, patients with a history of recurrent multiple furunculosis. On examination, generalized lymphadenopathy was present. Ophthalmic examination revealed horizontal nystagmus with hypopigmented fundus. Another interesting question. So this is a long question and a new pattern question. You can expect everybody. So I want all the 8 students to give me the answer, because only Raj, Ravi and Venkatesh have given me the answers of the previous question. Please, the other students also, try to make this class more interactive. Try to answer it now. Because see, if you will answer it, definitely you will make mistakes. And if you make mistakes now, you will not repeat that mistake in your exam. So I want you to try answering with me. Try to make this a habit. Try to answer with your teachers. Okay. So very nice. So till now, I have not seen anybody answering the question. What is the question says? A 3-year-old female born out of consanguineous marriage. Now, the first point or a first clue was that there is multiple furunculosis. There is a repeated history of infections. Second is, because of infections, definitely you will have generalized lymphadenopathy. Now, ophthalmic examination reveals that there is ocular changes in that patient. And skin biopsy, the skin lesions also present. Skin also consists of hypopigmented lesions. And the biopsy shows there is lack of melanin pigment. So what is given here? The melanin pigment is lost, but there is normal melanocyte. Now, can you tell me in which condition the melanocytes are normal, but the melanin pigment is absent? Among these options provided, can anybody tell me? In which all hypopigmentary disorders the melanocyte is normal, but there is decrease in the melanin formation in the melanocyte? The two answers given here is Griscelli syndrome and Chidack-Higashi syndrome. Please remember, in Griscelli and Chidack-Higashi, in both these conditions, the melanocyte count will be normal, but the melanin content or the production of melanin will be decreased. Now, how to differentiate between the first two options? Please remember, to differentiate between the first two options, remember that Griscelli syndromes, there is no ocular features. Ocular features are absent. Ocular features are absent. There is no ocular features in the patients of Griscelli syndrome. Please remember this point. But in Chidack-Higashi syndrome, you have involvement of the eyes, which presents with nystagmus as well as hypopigmentation of the fundus. Clear with this question? I want a thumbs up from all of you. The correct answer is Chidack-Higashi syndrome. And very well done, Suganya. Very well done, Raj Ravi. And I hope Venkatesan and Priya have also understood this question. Normal melanocyte, decreased production of melanin, giving rise to hypopigmentation. With normal eye or normal ocular symptoms, it is Griscelli. And with increased ocular features, it is Chidack-Higashi. Otherwise, everything is same. I assume everybody is clear. Please give me a thumbs up so that I can move to the next question. Quickly answer the next question. 13-year-old boy. History of burning sensation on exposure to sun. So on exposure to sun, there is burning sensation. There is grade 1 malnutrition and there is dull brown pigmentation with areas of speckled hyperpigmentation over the exposed part since 4 months, what could be the diagnosis? Rothman-Thompson syndrome, xeroderma pigmentosa, Cocaine syndrome or Bloom syndrome? Please answer this question, everyone. Rothman-Thompson. So they have given you sufficient hint. They have given you that the patient is having pigmentation and hypopigmentation. So what is this? This is called as reticulate pigmentation. Reticulate means like a net. There are few areas of pigmentation, few areas of hypopigmentation along with telangiectasias. What is this? Very well done. Please remember, so you have reticulate pigmentation, along with that you have telangiectasia, along with the skin atrophy. What does these three components include? Skin atrophy, telangiectasia and reticulate pigmentation. This classically is the component of poikiloderma. Poikiloderma. And what are the poikilodermatous syndromes you know of? There are three poikilodermatous syndrome. One is Rothman-Thompson. The second one is dyskeratosis congenita. And which is the third one? It is the Kindler syndrome. Kindler syndrome. Requesting all my dear students to remember this, poikilodermatous syndrome. I want everyone to give me a thumbs up if you are clear with this point. Everybody give me a thumbs up. Rothman-Thompson, xeroderma pigmentosa, Cocaine syndrome and Bloom syndrome. Very well done. Very nice, everyone. Very well done, all of you. Let's move to the next question. Let's answer the next question. A long question, so I will give you sufficient time to read it. The question says that a 43-year-old gentleman with a history of bronchial asthma and recently diagnosed distal gastric leiomyoma. He had noticed yellowish-orange discoloration of both the hands and feet for the past few weeks. He denied pruritus, darkening of the urine and pale stool. On examination, sclera was anecteric. His LFT, TSH and coagulation studies were within normal limit, and on further interview, the patient reported that for the past 6 months, his diet has predominantly consisted of papaya and mango. Anybody can answer this question. Very interesting. Read it as a whole. Very interesting question. Very nice, all the students. Very, very nice. So I think, am I visible? Because I'm not able to see whether I'm visible or not. Yes, 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 definitely. Okay, so please remember, the question says that because of the history of gastric leiomyoma, patient have restricted his diet to papaya and mango. And if you remember, papaya and mango are rich sources. They are rich sources of carotene. So this is a classical case of carotenemia. Okay, very important. Similar question we have found in your AIIMS exam few years back. The question related to carotenemia. So please try to remember this. Okay, so give me a thumbs up if this question is clear. Let's move to the next question. 25-year-old men develop small itchy wheels after physical exertion, walking in the sun, eating hot spicy food, and when he was angry. What is the most likely diagnosis? Chronic idiopathic urticaria, adrenergic urticaria, solar urticaria, or cholinergic urticarias. 25-year-old men develop small itchy wheels after physical exertion, walking in the sun, eating hot spicy food, and when he was angry. What is the most probable diagnosis? So Dr. Shikha, Ramu, Raj Ravi, Venkateshan, Suganya, Priya, everybody, requesting all my dear students to answer this question. Very well done, everyone. I can see good number of students. Very well done, all of you. Venkateshan, good. Okay, very nice, very nice. So here, please remember what happens whenever the patient is walking in the sun or eating hot spicy food, and whenever he is angry, what happens? The core body temperature increases. The core body temperature increases. Okay? Now what happens when the core body temperature increases? It sends signals to the preoptic area of hypothalamus. Now this preoptic area will then send the signal to the cholinergic sympathetic pathway, and this will give rise to micro wheels or very small papular wheels on the body. So this becomes a classical case of cholinergic urticaria. Very nice, everyone. The correct answer is option number 4. And why it is cholinergic urticaria? Because the preoptic area of the hypothalamus sends the signal through the cholinergic pathways. Chalo, very well done. The next question on your computer screen. Again, I am requesting all my students who are eligible for upcoming NEET PG entrance examination, who are not able to solve these questions or who are finding difficulty in solving these questions, please get a 1 month Unacademy subscription. Use my code Dr. Cheshta YT stands for YouTube, Dr. Cheshta YT, or you can use Cheshta 10 so that you will get extra discount on the subscription fees. This is the high time because only 1 month is left before your entrance examination. So please get yourself enrolled into this. Okay. Very nice, all of you. Very nice. So anybody with the answer of this question? Nobody have answered it till now. What happens? Venkateshan, Raj Ravi, Shikha, Suganya. So the question says that a 52-year-old male has uncontrolled diabetes, hypertension, and he is a case of airborne contact dermatitis. So whenever you have a severe dermatitis, you need to give steroids, oral and topical steroid. But in this case, you cannot give steroid because it can exacerbate diabetes and even blood pressure. So you will not give corticosteroid. Now the question comes, what should be your second drug of choice? Thalidomide, definitely no. There is not much effect of thalidomide in airborne contact dermatitis. Now you have to choose between azathioprine and cyclophosphamide. Please remember, cyclophosphamide is responsible for the increase in the BP because it causes kidney damage. So it causes renal hypertension, and that is why you cannot give cyclosporin because the patient is already a case of hypertension. So for this question, the correct answer becomes option number 3. The drug of choice in an uncontrolled diabetes and hypertensive patient becomes option number 3, that is azathioprine. I hope this question is clear. No confusion. Let's move to the next question. Quickly answer the question given on your computer screen. Please answer the question, everyone. Please answer the question. Very well done, all my students. Very well done. Very well done. Good. So, okay. Now again comes the question from sexually transmitted disease, repeating again and again. Please remember, all my NEET PG aspirants, STD and leprosy are the two topics which is very important for your upcoming entrance examination, that is NEET PG. Even if you are giving FMGE or INICT, whatever exam you are trying to give, these two topics cater a good number of questions. So please follow all the classes on STD. I'm also coming up with a plus course starting from 16th of March. Everybody, requesting you to join my class on 16th of the March, which is very important. I will be giving you detailed discussion of STD, leprosy and high yield topics related to dermatology. And remember, this is the last chance before your NEET PG entrance examination. So please use the code Dr. Cheshta YT and get a 1 month subscription. The question says that a patient gives you a history of 5 days. So the incubation period becomes less than 1 week. Along with that, they give history of burning micturition, urethral discharge, and on doing the microscopy, you have diplococci. It becomes very easy. Short incubation period and the gram stain of the discharge shows diplococci. It should be nothing other than the gonococcal urethritis. So please give me a thumbs up, Ramu, Gayatri, Dr. Shikha, Venkateshan and Suganya, if you understood this question. One of the very, very important questions for your upcoming entrance examination. Let's go to the next question. 40-year-old woman, Shelley, presented to dermatology OPD with a 2-year history of erythematous papulopustular lesions on convexity of the face. She reports that whenever she goes out for shopping or gets angry, she develops increased erythema over the face. On examination, we found that there is a background of telangiectasia. The most likely diagnosis is. So whenever she goes for shopping, see, this is such a irritating thing for this lady. Whenever she goes out in the sun for any purpose, she tend to get erythematous plaques, or erythema goes increasing on the face also when she is angry. So what is that thing which is making these lesions increasing? Very nice. What is the diagnosis here, everybody? Very nice. So whenever there is increase in the flushing of the face or presence of erythema and telangiectasia, it is nothing but a clear cut case of rosacea. Now Raj Ravi have mentioned option number 3. Please remember Raj Ravi, SLE, the flushing or the redness is constant. The redness is constant. What do you mean by constant? It means that it do not increase or decrease. It do not increase or decrease. It remains constant. And that is how you can differentiate a redness of SLE from that of rosacea. In rosacea, whenever there is increase in the core body temperature, or whenever there is sympathetic activity, there will be increase in the flushing. Understood? So Gayatri and Raj Ravi, who have marked option number 2, option number 3 as the answer, I request you to please give me a thumbs up if you understood this. Very important question, that there will be constant erythema in the patients of rosacea. Understood? Chalo, very well done. Next question. Quickly answer this question. A young female presented to emergency department with complaints of severe abdominal pain, bloody vomit, upper GI endoscopy was done, gastric carcinoma was diagnosed, and the patient was started on chemotherapy. 2 weeks later, she reports increased hair loss, for which dermatology reference was made. On doing the trichoscopy, the diagnosis was made. Yes, so Gayatri, please remember, telangiectasia is not something which is specific to rosacea or specific to SLE. Any of the disease which cause thinning of the skin will give rise to telangiectasia. But the point which I want you to concentrate here is, in rosacea there will be increase in the redness whenever the patient is exposed to the external environment, emotion or stress. But in other conditions like SLE, there will be no such increase or decrease in the lesion. I hope that is clear to you, Gayatri. Please say yes if you understood. Very well done. And I am getting the answers. Please remember, very important and a very easy question. Chemotherapy. What does chemotherapy agents do? Chemotherapy agents, they will act on the dividing cell. They will act on dividing cells. And dividing cells are present in the anagen phase. I hope you all know there is anagen, ketogen, anagen, telogen and catagen. And the dividing phase is the anagen phase. So what happens? Because of chemotherapy, there is sudden breaking of the hairs in the anagen phase, giving rise to anagen effluvium. So everybody is right here. No confusion. Requesting everyone to give me a thumbs up. Very, very easy question. Anagen effluvium. Dividing cells are affected and that is why they will shed off. Very nice. Alia, Gayatri, Venkatesh, Suganya, Gayatri, Rakesh, Jitendra. Everybody is right. Chalo, let's go to the next question. Quickly answer the next one. Primi gravida presented in the last second trimester with itchy erythematous papules and plaque that have progressed to tense vesiculobullous lesions over lower abdomen involving the periumbilical areas. Please answer this question, everyone. Please answer this question, all my dear students. Very nice everyone, good. I can see everybody with the correct answer, I guess. So, chalo. So, what is this question is saying you? That a primi gravida, look at the question, please try to read the question along with me. A primi gravida presented to you in second trimester, late second trimester, with itching, which is associated with tense vesiculobullous lesions. Now, if you remember my previous classes, I have told you, whenever you get the question saying tense bulla, it means that the level of cleft is present below the epidermis, that is either at the basement membrane zone or below it. Please give me a thumbs up if you are clear till here. So tense vesiculobullous lesion in a pregnant female, it means that only one disease, which is pemphigoid gestationalis. Pemphigoid gestationalis is also called as bullous pemphigoid of pregnancy. Okay. Now what is this bullous pemphigoid of pregnancy? Please remember, it occurs in the second and third trimester or in the late pregnancy. What happens, you all know that a fetus carries equal component of both mother and father. Now these component, as the father components which are present in the fetus, they are foreign to the maternal immune system. But what is happening, they are silenced. The maternal immune system is not exposed to the parental or the father component. But sometimes what happens, the trophoblastic cells of the fetus get exposed to the maternal immune system, giving rise to formation of antibodies against it. Now whenever you have formation of antibody against it, these antibodies will cross react with one of the component of basement membrane zone, that is BP180, giving rise to formation of the bulla, and that is what is happening in this patient. Now we will read each and every statement. The newborn may develop fluid filled lesions after delivery. It is true or false? Please remember, Raj Ravi and Venkatesh, this is true statement. You can see development of vesiculobullous lesions even in neonates. Estrogen is aggravating factor. Again, this is a true statement. Please remember, estrogen can aggravate this condition. It is associated with herpes virus. No, that is the wrong statement. It is not an infective condition. It is a immunobullous condition which occurs because of the cross reaction of the antibodies which are formed against trophoblastic cells, but now they are cross reacting with one of the component of the basement membrane zone. And option number 4 is again correct, that it can recur with subsequent pregnancies. Please everybody give me a thumbs up if this question is clear. Everyone give me a thumbs up. And this is sometimes also called as herpes gestationalis. But please remember, it is a misnomer. Misnomer means falsely named. Now why it was previously called as herpes gestationalis? Because it was thought, because of the presence of grouped vesicle, it was thought that it could be because of herpes. But later on, when the biopsies were done, when the investigations were done, it was found out that there is no role of herpes in them. So we have now given herpes gestationalis as a misnomer. Okay? Very well done. Another question on your computer screen is here. Another question on the computer screen is here. 2-year-old men had multiple small hypopigmented lesions. Please answer this question, everyone. Very nice, very well done all my dear students. Chalo, so again a very long question. So we can expect this type of long question now in the upcoming entrance examination. We can expect this. So what does the question say is that a 2-year-old man had multiple small hypopigmented macules on the upper chest and back for last 3 months. The macules were circular, arranged around the follicles, and they may had colles to form the large sheet. The surface of the macule shows fine scaling, and he had a similar lesions 1 year ago which subsided with the treatment. What will be the most appropriate bedside test? What will be the most appropriate bedside test which can be done in this question? Anyone can answer this? Yes, please remember, this is a classical case of pityriasis versicolor. I have told you few days back, versicolor. What points you have to remember? Perifollicular arrangement, hypopigmented or hyperpigmented lesions, presence of recurrence and what is the features on Wood's lamp, or the KOH mount will shows the presence of spaghetti and meatball or grape and banana appearance. On Wood's lamp, it will look yellow in color because of the pteridine molecule. So I think this question is right, Dr. Shikha, Rakesh, Jitendra, everybody. The correct answer is option number 1. Can you answer the next question given on the screen? So just out of curiosity, can anybody tell me how many of you are eligible for this upcoming NEET PG entrance examination? Ramu, Shikha, Rakesh, Jitendra, Kushram, Tarseem, how many of you are eligible for this upcoming NEET PG entrance examination? Please write yes over the chat section. Okay. Chalo. So this question says a 22-year-old female patient presented with multiple asymptomatic macules in 6 months. She was started with topical emollient and topical steroids by a local doctor, but there was perifollicular red orange appearance. Okay, so everybody, I think Shikha, Raj, Ravi, everybody is eligible. So please, this is a humble request to all these students, start preparing the long questions, the clinical case scenario questions. Start revising whatever you have read, because these type of questions, the lengthy questions, you will be expecting in your upcoming NEET PG entrance. Okay, so start reading system wise instead of reading subject wise. And especially the short subjects becomes very important now, because what we are expecting is, we are expecting that you will get direct questions from the short subjects, and the subjects like micro, patho, pharma, you will get more and more integrated questions out of them. So requesting everyone to please try reading it, in an integrated manner. We are already running a course that is system wise course. And that is not given by any other online platform. So if you are actually seriously want to go through the new pattern question, please join the Unacademy for at least a month so that you can revise with all these questions. Okay. Now for this question, the correct answer is given to me by Ramu and Suganya. I think I've already told this. Please remember, perifollicular orange red fluorescence on Wood's lamp is a feature of progressive macular amyloidosis, which is seen secondary to Propionibacterium acne species. In vitiligo and post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation, you will have white fluorescence, and in pityriasis versicula, you have a yellow fluorescence. Okay, so that is how you can differentiate. And also another point is, topical emollient and steroids, both these will given to a vitiligo patients will respond. Okay, chal. Next question on the computer screen, everyone. A 53-year-old lady present with medical assessment unit with a flu-like illness and myalgia. In the last few days, she noticed a rash across her back. She has no other symptoms. On examination, she looks unwell. There is an erythematous rash across the back and she has a grade 4-5 weakness proximally. Her creatinine kinase, which is elevated at 1052 international unit, and a renal function test is normal. What is the diagnosis? So Gayatri says it is option number 3. What about Ramu and other students? Very well done. So I think it's a very easy question. The skin manifestation or the dermatological features along with proximal muscle weakness. The dermatological feature along with proximal muscle weakness is a feature of dermatomyositis. They have clearly mentioned in the question. And yes, you are right, Gayatri. This clinical features which is present is the shawl sign, which is seen in the patients of dermatomyositis. Very well done, everyone. Very well done. Chalo, please answer the next question. Please answer the next question. Thank you. Please answer the next question, all of you. Very nice, very nice, very nice. So what is the question says? The question says that a 70-year-old female present with pruritic eruptions on her lower abdomen since 10 days. On examination, there was a tens bulla. Again, same thing. Tens bulla means subepidermal split. Now, second clue given is that it's an elderly patient. Elderly patient. And the blisters have eosinophils with associated erythema around the lesions. They have given you sufficient hint for telling you the diagnosis of bullous pemphigoid. Very nice, Ramu. Now, Suganya, please remember, linear IgA dermatosis will not present like this. In linear IgA dermatosis, they will give you a history that there are large bulla surrounded by small vesicles like this, which is called as string of pearl, which is called as string of pearl or cluster of jewel appearance. Okay, string of pearl or cluster of jewel appearance. Very nice, all of you. Very well done. Chalo, so I think this question is clear. Next, coming to the next question, a 6-year-old boy with the Down syndrome present with a large warty crust. Again, a repeat question requesting all of you to quickly answer this question. We have already discussed what happens when a patient is a case of a Down syndrome. Yes, so what happens in a patient of Down syndrome? The itch sensation. In a patient of Down syndrome, the itch sensation is reduced. The itching of the patient goes far below, or the sensation of the itching goes down. When the sensation of itching goes down, there is more and more proliferation of the lesion, and this will give rise to a specific type of scabies, which is called as Norwegian scabies. Norwegian scabies will have more of the eczematous component, and the reason behind this eczematous component is because of presence of what? Because of the presence of more and more, or loss of itching sensation, more and more proliferation of the parasite, giving rise to widespread lesions. Very nice, Alia, Suganya, Tarshim, Raj Ravi, Rakesh, Vishnu, Shikha, everybody is right for this question. Let's go to the next question. Everybody, so very nice and happy to see that we have a good number of students today with us, and everybody is participating in answering the questions. There are few students who are not answering yet, so I request you to please answer everyone. Try to make this class more interactive. Try to ask lot and lot of questions. See, if questions are coming in your mind, don't stop it. Okay, try to ask the questions, but yes, definitely related to the topic only. Chalo, very well done. Now, what does the question say is that a 52-year-old female was admitted to dermatology ward with pruritic erythematous. So, one is erythematous and the second is migratory plaque. There is associated stomatitis, weight loss. Investigation reveals that there is glucagon level which is increased, glucagon level, and there is pancreatic tumor. So, what is the answer? No, it is not option number 2. Rakesh, Vishnu and Ramu, this is a classical case of erythema. What is it? Necrolytic migratory erythema. And what is necrolytic migratory erythema? It is a paraneoplastic condition, which is seen in glucagonoma, okay? And you can see that in this patient, there is raised glucagon and blood sugar level, and it is a pancreatic islets and tumor. So this becomes a classical case of necrolytic migratory erythema. And please remember, necrobiosis lipoidica, the name itself says diabeticorum. So it is a feature of late diabetes. It is not a paraneoplastic condition. It has been given in the question itself. So please don't make this mistake. The question, the option itself says it is not the answer. The answer is necrolytic migratory erythema. I request everyone to please give me a thumbs up if you are clear with this point. Theek hai? Chalo. Well done. 10-month-old infant presented to with fever, tenderness, erythematous skin rash, blistering and crusting erosions, especially in the perioral and in the fold. Mucosa was spared, family and antenatal history was unremarkable, and parent denies any drug intake prior to onset of the skin rash. They gave history of ear infections 2 weeks back. Please answer this question, everyone. It's a very easy question. Try to pick up the hints given in the question. So, Alia, I want you to please read the question again. So, you have written acrodermatitis enteropathica, but please read the question. What does the last line says? The last line says that the parents give a history of ear infection. So, is there any significance about this line? Anyone, is there any significance of this ear infection? Why do acrodermatitis enteropathica will have an ear infection, or they will write this in the question? So please remember, this is a case of staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome, and ear infection is a focus of staphylococcus. Please remember, it is not acrodermatitis enteropathica. It's not that always when you get a periorificial eczema, it becomes acrodermatitis enteropathica. No. Whenever a patient gets blistering disease with associated ear infection or preceding a ear infection, it becomes a case of staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome, where the staphylococcus releases an exfoliative toxin which through blood circulation reaches the skin, inhibit the desmoglein 1, giving rise to blister formation at the subcorneal level. Clear? Please give me a thumbs up, Alia, Rakesh, Ramu, those who have answered option number 3, please give me a thumbs up if you understood this. Everyone give me a thumbs up. The correct answer of this question becomes option number 4, not option number 3, not option number 1, not option number 2. Okay? So this becomes a classical case of staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome. Next question. Vijay is a 15-year-old male who presented to us with complaints of red firm papules on the face, mainly around the nose and the mouth. Further examination reveals lenticulate hypopigmented macules on the trunk. The most appropriate diagnosis is you have lenticulate hypopigmentation. What becomes the most appropriate diagnosis in this case? Acne vulgaris, acne rosacea, perioral dermatitis, or tuberous sclerosis? Anybody for this answer? Very important, read it carefully. Alia, Gayatri, Ramu, Shikha, Raj Ravi, Suganya, Rakesh, Venkateshan, everyone please answer this question. And those who are joining us now, please answer the questions. I want each and every one of you to give me an option. Very nice. So I think you all understood this is a classical case of tuberous sclerosis. What are these red firm papules over the face? These are adenoma sebaceum. What are these lenticulate oval-shaped lesions? What are these lenticulate hypopigmented macules? What are these? These are nothing but ash leaf spot. And both these features are seen in the patients of tuberous sclerosis. Very well done, all my students. I think everybody is right. Gayatri, Raj Ravi, Rakesh, Shikhar, Ramu, Alia, and so on. Everybody is right for this question. Quickly answer the next question given on the computer screen. 2-month-old male child with severe itching, irritability, generalized erythematous papule, few pustules, vesicles which involve the face, palm, soles, intense nocturnal itching with web space involvement was present in the mother and the elder brother as well. What is the correct statement? Two-month-old male presented with severe itching, irritability, generalized erythematous papule, few pustules, vesicles involving face, palms, soles as well. History of intense nocturnal itching with the web space involvement was present in the mother and the elder brother as well. What is the correct statement here? Please answer this question quickly, quickly. So this is a classical case of scabies. I think everybody have understood till here. That whenever you have nocturnal itching, family history positive, involvement of the web space, it becomes a classical case of scabies. So the question what they are asking is, what is the correct statement regarding the scabies? What is the correct statement regarding the scabies? Very well done, all my dear student. The correct answer here is option number 1. 5% permethrin is the drug of choice. Now why the other options are wrong? Please remember, topical sulfur can be used. It can be used in infant and breastfeeding mother. It is a safe drug. Oral ivermectin. Oral ivermectin do not work on sodium channel. It works on GABA channels. GABA channels. It works on GABA channels. And topical lending cannot be used in children or pregnant female because it crosses the blood-brain barrier and can cause paralysis or seizures in the children or pregnant female. So you do not give it. So the only correct option provided is 5% permethrin is the drug of choice. Very nice everyone. Chalo, quickly answer the next question. 9-year-old girl with appearance of multiple vesicles which enlarge to form flaccid bulla which has purulent content. When they rupture, they leave behind brown crusting. What is the most likely cause of the disease? Quickly answer all my students. Again requesting everyone, because I can see many of you are eligible for upcoming NEET PG entrance examination. Please join the batch on system wise preparation, the only batch course which is the only platform which is giving you a last moment batch course for the new pattern questions of NEET PG. So please get a 1 month subscription so that you will be aware how exactly you will get the question. Don't try to switch on to something new now. Don't try to buy, because I've seen many students are asking me, ma'am, whether we should go ahead with the USMLE papers. Please don't try it yourself, because USMLE is by themselves a very broad thing. You cannot cover it in 1 month. So we have curated few questions which will give you an idea about the upcoming pattern. So please join the subject wise or the system wise revision for NEET PG. Okay. Very nice. So this question tells you that a patient have flaccid bulla. Flaccid means intraepidermal vesicle. So intraepidermal means it cannot be option number 1, it cannot be option number 3. Now the next thing which is given is purulent, which means pus. And whenever pus comes into play, it means that you are dealing with an infective condition. And what is the infective condition which presents with intraepidermal? Please give me a thumbs up, all my students, please give me a thumbs up. Bullous impetigo, that is infection by Staphylococcus aureus. What is bullous impetigo? Infection by Staphylococcus aureus. Chalo, good. Another question on the computer screen. 25-year-old male with recurrent episodes of flexural eczemas, contact urticarias, recurrent skin infections and severe abdominal cramps, diarrheas. Upon taking the seafood, he is suffering from... men presents with recurrent episodes of flexure, eczema, urticaria, recurrent infection, severe abdominal cramp, diarrhea upon taking the seafood is suffering from. Please answer this question, all my dear students. Try to answer this. Very well done. So what are this combination tells you? Flexural eczema, recurrent infection, abdominal cramp, diarrhea on taking seafood. It is a classical case of atopic dermatitis. What is pneumular dermatitis? Suganya, please remember, pneumular dermatitis, it is classically having discoid lesions like this. Discoid lesions means uniform consistency circular lesions which is present over the body. circular lesions with uniform consistency is called as numular dermatitis or discoid dermatitis. Clear? Suganya, please give me a thumbs up if this question is clear. Next question on the computer screen, please answer this one. Please answer, a 36-year-old male from Bihar comes with the complaint of hypopigmented macule on the trunk and the face. Nerves and sensation are tested to be normal. No scaling is visible in the lesion. Patient gives history of prolonged fever 2 years back for which he was treated. What is the drug of choice for treating this condition? Very nice, everyone. So a 36-year-old male from Bihar comes with complaints of hypopigmented macules over the trunk and face. The nerves and the sensations are tested to be normal. No scaling is visible. Please remember, what are they telling you? They are telling you that a patient gives a history of prolonged fever along with hypopigmented lesions. What is the diagnosis? Very nice. It is a case of post-Kala-Azar dermal leishmaniasis. And for post-Kala-Azar dermal leishmaniasis, the drug of choice, which is the correct option given, is by Dr. Shikha, that is miltefosine. Now, why I have not marked sodium stibogluconate as the answer here? Because sodium stibogluconate is an injectable drug, which cannot be a drug of choice. Oral miltefosine is an oral drug. You don't have to be hospital settings to give miltefosine. You can easily give miltefosine, but sodium stibogluconate has to be given in the hospital setting. Lot of infusion reactions seen secondary to sodium stibogluconate, and that is why we will consider option number 4 as the correct answer. I think this is clear to everyone. Please answer the next question. 22-year-old farmer with a history to trauma over his left foot while walking barefoot on the fields. He has presented with development of the warty growths over the left foot. On doing the biopsy, the report reveals the brown colored bodies. What is the diagnosis? Very nice, all of you, very nice. 22-year-old farmer with a history of trauma on his left foot while walking barefoot on the field. He has presented with development of the warty growth over the left foot. On doing the biopsy, the report reveals the brown colored bodies. What is the diagnosis? Very well done, everyone. Very, very well done. Please remember, the correct answer here is chromoblastomycosis. Verrucous growth and the brown color bodies, which are nothing but the copper penny bodies or medullar bodies or sclerotic bodies. Okay, all these names are given to one entity, and that is the chromoblastomycosis. Very nice, and happy to see everybody's response. Another question on the computer screen. I want everybody to answer this question as well. Please answer, all my dear students. Patient develops bulla without erythema on elbow, knee and sacral area, followed by formation of crusting. What will be the correct answer? Very nice, very nice. Absolutely right, Alia. So what is that point which help you differentiate between option number 1 and 2? I think everybody is clear that it is a mechanobullous disorder, and two options which belongs to mechanobullous disorder is option number 1 and 2. Now the thing is, you have to choose one among these two. Please remember, the DIF is negative here. So Alia, will you see negative DIF in EB acquisita or EB dystrophica? Everybody have written the answer ulta. What is the correct answer? If DIF is negative, it is a classical case of EB dystrophica. Understood? I have just twisted this question a little bit. instead of giving you DIF positive, I've written the DIF negative. Please remember, don't make this mistake in your exam. What I did, I have written DIF negative. In EB Acquisitor, remember DIF will be positive, because in EB Acquisitor you have antibodies against collagen 7. So how will the DIF becomes negative? If this is clear, I want a thumbs up from all my students. This is very, very important for you to remember. Okay? Understood this question? Please give me a thumbs up and start doing the next question given on the... Please start doing the question which is given on your computer screen. Very nice, very nice. Chalo. So I think I was able to twist the question and make you confused. But please remember, this is how, that is how the examiner will play from your mind. Even if you know the answer, try to read it carefully. See, what they will do, they will give you a repeat question, but they will change the language little bit, and that change in the language will trap you. Okay, so please don't get trapped. Answer the next question given on the computer screen. Very nice, very nice, very nice, Rakesh. Absolutely right. Very quick answer. Anybody else want to answer this question? Very nice, Jitendra. What about Alia, Gayatri, Dr. Shikha, Raj Ravi, Suganya, everyone? Yes, the correct answer is, whenever you see a plaque or a annular lesion over the buttock with central atrophy, it is nothing but a case of cutaneous tuberculosis, and the commonest cutaneous tuberculosis is lupus vulgaris. So I hope this session was interesting and a lot informative for everyone. If you like my today's session, please give me a review. You can like my class, you can write the comments over the chat section. And again, requesting everybody who is eligible for upcoming NEET PG entrance examination, please take a 1 month subscription of Unacademy using the code CHESTA10 or Dr. CHESTAYT, because we are conducting a system wise batch course which I've started recently to prepare you for the new pattern questions of NEET PG. Okay. So thank you all of you for the patience listening, and bye bye. Take care. We'll meet again.